Good morning, church family. It's my pleasure this morning to welcome you to the Palm Sunday service streaming here at First Baptist Church, North Kansas City this morning. As we kind of make our way into the virtual sanctuary this morning together, I want to give you an opportunity to get settled, cast it to another device if you want to. You can create a watch party and share it with people in your Facebook group if you know how to do that, and also just a chance to sort of welcome each other. As we do that, I'm going to read a short reading that was passed on to me by Spencer. It says, 8th century martyr Andrew of Crete wrote, "Let us say to Christ, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, the King of Israel. Let us wave before him like branches the words inscribed above him on the cross. Let us show him honor, not with olive branches, but with the splendor of merciful deeds to one another. Let us spread the thoughts and desires of our hearts under his feet like garments, so that he may draw the whole of our being into himself and place the whole of his in us." We'll begin our worship this morning with "All Creatures of Our God and King." So lyrics are out there and available. I'm not sure if they're linked directly to the stream this week, but if you check your email for weekly updates, you can find lyrics to the song in the email right under the first section. This version of "All Creatures of Our God and King" was put together by the Norton Hall Band, which is the praise band for Southern Seminary. So it's a little different than the hymnal, but I hope you enjoy it. Creatures of our God and King, lift up your voice and with us sing. Oh, praise him, hallelujah. Thou burning sun with golden beam, thou silver moon with softer gleam. Oh, praise him. Oh, praise him, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Let all things their creator bless, and worship him in humbleness. Oh, praise him, hallelujah. Praise, praise the Father, praise the Son, and praise the Spirit, three in one. Oh, praise him, oh, praise him. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. All the redeemed washed by the blood, come and rejoice in his great love. Oh, praise him, hallelujah. Christ has defeated every sin. Cast all your burdens now on him. Oh, praise him, oh, praise him, hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah. He shall return in power to reign. Heaven and earth will join to sing.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
Join us as we continue our worship this morning with Shine, Jesus, Shine.
Lord, the light of your love is shining in the midst of the darkness, shining. Jesus, light of the world, shine upon us. Set us free by the truth you now bring us. Shine on me. Shine on me. Shine, Jesus, shine. Fill this land the Father's glory, blaze, Spirit, blaze, set our hearts on fire. Flow, river, flow, flood the nations with grace and mercy. Send forth your word, Lord, and let there be light. From the shadows into your radiance, by the blood I may enter your brightness. Search me, try me, consume all my darkness. Shine on me, shine on me. Shine, Jesus, shine. Fill this land with the Father's glory. Spirit blaze, set our hearts on fire. Flow, river, flow, flood the nations with grace and mercy. Send forth your word, Lord, and let there be light. As we gaze on your King, brightness, so our faces display your likeness, ever changing from glory to glory. Mirrored here, may our lives tell your story. Shine on me, shine on me. Shine, Jesus, shine. Fill this land with the Father's glory. Set our hearts on fire. Flow, river, flow, flood the nations with grace and mercy. Send forth your word, Lord, and let there be light.
Good morning. I'll be reading from Psalm 118 today. Psalm 118 is a part of the Hallel. Psalm 113 through 118 are special messianic scriptures that the Hebrews would read on special occasions, looking forward to their Messiah. And our messianic Christian Jews today still read these psalms on at the time of the Lord's Supper, or special occasions. Certainly, this psalm would have been read at the Passover that Jesus was marching into today, as we recall that event. And so I want to read from this. You'll recognize some of the verses are actually words of praise that the crowd gave to Jesus as he came into Jerusalem. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. Let Israel say, his love endures forever. Let the house of Aaron say, his love endures forever. Let those who fear the Lord say, his love endures forever. And continuing, the Lord is my strength and my defense. He has become my salvation. Shouts of joy and victory resound in the tents of the righteous. The Lord's right hand has done mighty things. The Lord's right hand is lifted high. The Lord's right hand has done mighty things. I will not die, but live and will proclaim what the Lord has done. The Lord has chastened me severely, but he has not given me over to death. Open for me the gates of the righteous. I will enter and give thanks to the Lord. This is the gate of the Lord through which the righteous may enter. I will give you thanks, for you answered me. You have become my salvation. The stone the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. The Lord has done this, and it is marvelous in our eyes. The Lord has done it. This very day, let us rejoice today and be glad. Lord, save us. Lord, grant us success. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. From the house of the Lord, we bless you. The Lord is God, and he has made his light shine on us with bows in hand and join in the festival procession up to the horns of the altar. You are my God, and I will praise you. You are my God, and I will exalt you. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, and his love endures forever. Readings from Psalm 118.
We will continue our worship with Hosanna, Praise is Rising. Hosanna is a word we're going to sing a lot today, so we'll start singing it now.
Praise is rising, eyes are turning to you, we turn to you. The day in your presence, all our fears are washed away, washed away. Hosanna, Hosanna, you are the God who saves us, worthy of all our praises. Hosanna. Have your way among us. We welcome you here, Lord Jesus. Hear the sound of hearts returning to you. We turn to you. See you, we find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away, washed away. Hosanna, Hosanna, you are the God who saves us, worthy of all our praises. Hosanna, Hosanna, come have your way among us. We welcome you here, Lord Jesus. When we see you, we find strength to face the day. Your presence, all our fears are washed away. When we see you, we find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away. Washed away. Hosanna, Hosanna, you are the God who saves us, worthy of all our praises. Hosanna, Hosanna, come have your way among us. We welcome you here, Lord Jesus.
We'll continue our worship with a song called Oh Praise the Only One. We've done it several times here together. I'm going to go ahead and play through the first verse once to remind you how it sounds, and then we'll jump right in and sing together.
There is no greater truth than this. There is no stronger love we know. God Himself comes down to live and makes the sinner's heart His throne. There is no deeper peace than this. No other kindness can compare. He clothes us in His righteousness, forever free, forever heirs. Oh, praise the only one who shines brighter than 10,000 suns. Death and hell call Him victorious. Praise Him. Oh, praise the one true King. Lift it loud till earth and heaven ring. Every crown we lay down at His feet. Praise Him. There is no sweeter joy than this. There is no stronger hope we hold. We are His forevermore. Safe, secure by Christ alone. Oh, praise the only one who shines brighter than 10,000 suns. Death and hell call Him victorious. Praise Him. Oh, praise the one true King. Let it loud till earth and heaven ring. Every crown we lay down at His feet. Praise Him. Praise Him, praise Him, praise Him. There is no sound that's like the song that rises up from grateful saints. We once were lost, but now we're found. One with Him, we bear His name. Oh, praise the only one who shines brighter than 10,000 suns. Death and hell call Him victorious. Praise Him. Oh, praise the one true King. Lift it loud till earth and heaven ring. Every crown we lay down at His feet. him, praise him, praise him, praise him. Praise him, praise him, praise him, praise him.
There are many things that are on our minds this day. Certainly, the world situation with the COVID-19 virus weighs heavy. And it's in the forefront of our minds, and we're living it out. And that's going to be on our hearts today. But also, this day is Palm Sunday. It's Jesus coming to Jerusalem as our King, and we want to receive our King and all of the peace that comes through Jesus being our victory, Jesus being our triumph. Let us pray together. Gracious Father, we pray for the global church as she marks Holy Week, especially for those who are not able to gather in person, that we would rejoice greatly over our Jesus who saved us with his perfect life and sacrificial death, and who comes to us humbly and continually through his Spirit. Jesus, we pray for ourselves that we would be granted faithfulness in times of temptation, repentance and forgiveness when we fall, love for all our brothers and sisters in you, reconciliation with those from whom we are alienated, and boldness to confess the faith we have in you. Holy Spirit, we pray for this body of believers that we would be given faithful and generous hearts to prayerfully and financially support your mission and ministry locally, nationally, and around the globe. Triune God, we pray for those who live without faith in Christ that this Holy Week, your Spirit would call them to repentance and to give them the gift of faith to believe in the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Church, pray with me the Lord's Prayer. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And deliver and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen and amen.
Well, for the music this week, what better than to sing Hosanna? So we're going to sing another Hosanna. Join me, please. See the King of glory coming on the clouds with fire. The whole earth shakes, the whole earth shakes. I see his love and mercy washing over all our sin. The people sing, the people sing. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest.
I see a generation rising up to take their place with selfless faith, selfless faith. I see a near revival stirring as we pray and see. We're on our knees, we're on our knees. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Heal my heart and make it clean. Open up my eyes to the things unseen. Show me how to love like you have loved me. Break my heart for what breaks yours. Everything I am for your kingdom's cause. As I walk from earth into eternity. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest.
We have some branches on the altar today. We're not able to have the palm branches, but I understand that many believers, lots of churches, are collecting any kind of branch, that we would pay homage to our Savior and lay them before Him and wave them before Him. The palm branches and the branches that were laid in the path for Jesus. They're a way of expressing allegiance and loyalty and belief in the King Jesus. And so our branches today, although not palm branches, express our love for Jesus Christ and our allegiance to Him. And I've even seen that some are cutting branches and putting them on their doors or thresholds and windows so that as others pass by, they may know that there is the home of a believer, one who trusts in Jesus Christ. Well, that's our story today, paying homage to the King of Kings. It's recorded in all the Gospels. It takes a lot of the ink that is printed in our Bibles, in the New Testament, in the Gospels, the overwhelming amount of the details that are recorded from this week forward in Jesus' ministry. That points to the fact that Jesus journeying to the cross is so profound to our faith. Let us read together from one of those accounts in the book of Matthew, Matthew 21. As they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethphage on Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go to the village ahead of you, and at once you will find a donkey tied there with her colt by her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, say that the Lord needs them, and he will send them right away." This took place to what was spoken through the prophet. "Say to daughter Zion, see, your king comes to you, gentle and riding on a donkey, and on a colt, the foal of a donkey." The disciples went and did as Jesus had instructed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and placed their cloaks on them for Jesus to sit on. A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, while others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. The crowds that went ahead of him and those that followed shouted, "Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord! Hosanna in the highest heaven!" When Jesus entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred and asked, "Who is this?" And the crowds answered, "This is Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth in Galilee." I want to recount some of what has transpired preceding up to Jesus' triumphal entry into Jerusalem on this reading. And then I want to go into some of the events of this coming week and what we commemorate and what we remember and why is it called Holy Week or Passion Week. I'm reminded of a poem that I learned long ago, an unknown author. Three men went down the road, the man he was, the man they saw, and the man he wanted to be. In so many ways, that poem really applies to what's happening here, both for the people who they were and what Jesus saw in them and the people that they wanted to be, but also for Jesus, the man he was, the man they saw, and the man he wanted to be to the people, for the people, that they should receive him. There were some very close friends and followers of Jesus Christ. They lived in the city of Bethany. Bethphage, it says in our passage today in chapter 21, verse 1, as they approached Jerusalem and came from Bethphage on the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two of his disciples. Bethany and Bethphage are right next to each other. It is believed that Bethphage was really a hamlet to Bethany, and it sits across on a hill from Jerusalem. And Jerusalem can look over and see Bethany, and Bethany and Bethphage can look over and see Jerusalem. Last night, Saturday night, the evening before our Palm Sunday, Jesus would have been in the home of Simon the leper, who lived in Bethany. You might call him Simon the healed leper. He wouldn't have been allowed. He would have been isolated had he had an active leprosy. So Simon the healed leper is hosting a meal, and some other residents of Bethany are there. Well, there's Lazarus, who Jesus had resurrected, his sisters Martha and Mary, the disciples. So they are having a meal. And at this meal, Mary brings an alabaster flask and she breaks it open. And it's a very expensive, fragrant ointment and perfume imported from the Himalayan mountains. She's anointing Jesus with it. And one of the disciples says, "Why the waste?" Turns out, if we look at other gospels, that disciple was Judas. Turns out he's the betrayer, the treasurer of the group. Why the waste? And he got other disciples to say, "Why the waste?" It would have been fitting for a prophet, a priest, or a king to be anointed with such a fine, fragrant ointment. And certainly Jesus is that prophet, priest, and king, and more. He is our Savior. He is our Lord. He is Almighty God. It was expensive. There's all kinds of numbers put on what that fragrant perfume would have cost. Suffice it to say, the average man's yearly wage being poured out on Jesus, and the disciples asking, why the waste? Certainly, again, would have been fitting for a prophet, a priest, or a king to have been anointed with this. Jesus was that and more. But Jesus told them, she's preparing me for my burial. The ointment, the fragrant ointment, perfume, was also used for burying people, in some ways to hide the odor of a decaying body. So while he was worthy of this anointing, and they didn't get it, the disciples, they called out, why the waste? He was worthy. And they didn't get that it was to prepare him for his burial. The next morning, Sunday, our Sunday morning, our Palm Sunday morning, is Jesus' triumphal entry. And he said, go to the village ahead of you, and at once you will find a donkey tied there with her colt by her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, say that the Lord needs them, and he will send them right away. And this took place to fulfill what was spoken by the prophet. Prophet Zechariah, chapter 9, gives this account hundreds of years before it happened. Say to the daughter Zion, see, your king comes to you, gentle and riding on a donkey and on a colt, the foal of a donkey. This is also quoted in Zechariah chapter 9, as well as in Isaiah 62. But in Isaiah 62, it is added, see, your Savior comes. Say to the daughter of Zion, see, your king comes. See, your Savior comes. And then the disciples went and did as Jesus had instructed them, and they brought the donkey and the colt and placed their cloaks on them for Jesus to sit on. And a very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, while others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. And I've already mentioned that the branches were paying homage. And they were palm branches. And palm branches were being waved and laid out, a red carpet for the king. But there was a view of the man they saw that was not what most of them knew to be correct. It was not the right view of Jesus that they had. And then there was Jesus' view of them and all of this as he's approaching Jerusalem. I'm going to turn to Luke chapter 19. In Luke 19, it talks about how Jesus saw them as he approached and saw the city. He wept over it and said, if you even had only known on this day what would bring you peace, but now it is hidden from your eyes. They had spiritual blindness. They had spiritual blindness, and he was weeping over this. Yes, the crowds were saying, Hosanna, deliver us, save us now. And Jesus is able to do all of that. But what they had in mind was someone to save them from the oppression of the Roman occupiers. The Romans could conscript people to work in quarries and pull out heavy stones and build buildings and build roads. The Romans, if you didn't comply, would crucify or kill you by the sword. The Romans had imposed high oppressive taxes on people. It was hard being a Jewish citizen under the Romans. They were wanting a deliverer to come with the sword, a warrior, and deliver them. And Jesus wept. Jesus wept, it says, as he looked on them because they did not see him for who he was. He is a Savior. He is our King. And he would be all of that to them if they only had spiritual eyes to see. But they had been blinded. They had every reason to want to be delivered from the Roman occupation. But Jesus was coming on a donkey, a humble animal, sometimes ridden by royalty, but mostly kings would come on horses, especially warrior kings, especially ones saying, "Here I come," with their sword, and Jesus is on a donkey. This donkey represented that Jesus was coming as their Lord and King, but in a humble way, as a Savior, as a sacrificial lamb, and not with the sword. That he would be able to save them and us from the worst of days here on earth by giving us hope, by giving us strength, by giving us eternal life. Jesus could also see, as it is recorded in Luke 19, if you had had eyes to have known, but your eyes, but it is hidden from you. It continued, the days will come upon you when your enemies will build an embankment against you and encircle you and hem you in on every side. They will dash you to the ground and you and your children within the walls, and they will not leave one stone on another because you did not recognize the time of God's coming. There's several things there. That destruction did come in AD 70, and the Romans did surround Jerusalem. And it was 142, 143-day siege, and then they pummeled it. And they killed hundreds of thousands within the city walls of Jerusalem. Oh, Jesus wanted to spare them of that. And he grieved over that. Because he wants his people to have gladness. Jesus wants us to have gladness and hope and joy. Our situation today with COVID-19 may cause grief and it may cause fear. And Jesus will weep over that with us. As he sees our suffering, as he sees our pain, as he sees our struggles, as he sees the things that cause us to wonder what will happen next, he will grieve that with us. He will never leave us nor forsake us. He will be our anchor. He will be our stronghold. He is our hope. He is our joy. He is our gladness. Jesus is all of that. He wants us to have joy. He wants us to have hope. And he has come. He has come and journey to the cross so that we might have everlasting hope and everlasting life. And we can draw strength from God. They didn't see that. And the Romans did pummel Jerusalem in AD 70. Many Christians were spared because Christ had also spoken in Luke that when you see the armies surround, you will know it's time to leave the city. And church tradition holds that many of those Christians within Jerusalem fled to the mountains, specifically to Pella, and they were spared. So they were spared in the physical, temporal life that we are journeying through here, but they also had eternal life. So after his triumphal entry, Jesus goes through the crowd. They're having Hosanna, save us now, deliver us. What they have in mind is not exactly what he has set out to do. There's a misunderstanding. Sunday night, Jesus goes back to Bethany. It's just a few miles away. He spends the night. The next morning, he comes going back into Jerusalem. He sees a fig tree that's all leafed out. So this is tomorrow, Monday, what we might commemorate or remember on Holy Monday. He sees the fig tree with leaves not in season. He sees, as he approaches closer, that it bears no fruit. It's a false advertising, if you will. I'm a fig tree, I'm all leafed out, and yet I have no fruit. And Jesus curses the fig tree, and it dies. What's that all about? Well, in so many ways, the religious people that were also watching Jesus on that triumphal entry, the Jewish leaders, had in mind the Messiah that they wanted. And it wasn't Jesus. They wanted a Messiah that fit their mold into their religious concepts and framework and structure. Maybe the fig tree then is an illustration of how they can all be leafed out, putting on the airs and having the appearance and the presence of being right with God. And yet you look a little closer, there was no fruit. And they too were blinded. So the fig tree could be any believer today who is going through the motions of, I'm a believer, I follow Christ. But then you look a little further. Their life and their lifestyle and their choices don't match up. Their care for others is not there. Their service to others is not there. There's no fruit. Holy Monday is also a day that we're reminded that Jesus cleansed or cleared or cleaned the temple. The temple, outer court, all of Jerusalem is just flooded with people because of the Passover. The population is 10 times or more what is normal. And the temple courts are full. And in the outer temple courts, people are coming in, but the Gentiles can go no further than the outer court. And in that outer court, there are the money exchangers, because people are coming with their currency from wherever they are from, and they have money exchangers. And they are charging fees that are high and exorbitant and gouging to exchange the money, to pay the temple tax, to buy the sacrificial lambs. And then they also have the sacrificial lambs for the Jews to buy. And they're charging high and outrageous prices. So we have the setting where the Gentiles can go no further in the outer court. And all they can hear and see around them is the money being exchanged and the gouging of prices going on. And Jesus clears that. And he quotes Isaiah 56:7. My house shall be a house of prayer for all the nations, for all peoples, for everyone. So Holy Monday, tomorrow, reflect and remember Jesus' encounter with the fig tree. Reflect and remember Jesus' encounter at the temple. Holy Tuesday and Holy Wednesday are the times that Jesus is out teaching parables, and the Sadducees, the Pharisees, the Herodians are conspiring how to entrap Jesus. And Wednesday, it is remembered that Judas conspired with the Sanhedrin to betray Jesus and hand him over to the co-conspirators, the enemies of Jesus. Maundy Thursday, Thursday evening of this coming week, Maundy Mandate, Commandment Thursday, was Jesus' last meal with the disciples, the Last Supper, a Passover meal, and he predicts with them and for them the things that will happen, and even that one of them will betray him. And he gives them symbols to remember him by. This bread is my body, broken for you. And he gives them an important Christian principle at that meal, that the greatest are to serve. As they had clamored for who would be greatest in Jesus' kingdom, he's saying, the greatest will serve. And he himself is being that servant leader, sacrificial servant leader, as he had washed their feet that night, expressing his love for them, his service to them. As a model to all believers, as Jesus washed feet, as Jesus served, we are to care and to serve as well. Then there's Holy or Silent Saturday, to remember the time Jesus spent in the tomb, to remember the life that Jesus had led and the life that he gave. Because on Good Friday, Jesus was crucified. His blood is the most precious thing that God could ever offer us. And on Saturday, we remember that he's made this sacrifice for us. What's good about Good Friday? It's a good question, because that is the day that Christ was crucified. But it is the day that he made it possible for us to have eternal life through his precious blood. So when we come back next Sunday, we will have Resurrection Sunday. And Passion Week will be coming to a close as we celebrate the victory that comes in Jesus Christ. He appeared to the women and then to Peter and to the 12 on that day. And so today, we have a Jesus who came into Jerusalem. The man he was, the man they saw, and the man he wanted to be. And the people were saying, Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Jesus deserves that praise. He deserves that recognition. He is our Savior. He saves now. In Matthew 21, verse 10, when Jesus entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred and asked, "Who is this?" The crowds answered who he was, "Prophet from Nazareth in Galilee," and they were correct. That is true. But it is so much more. Remember when Jesus appeared to Peter and the disciples and he asked them, "Who do people say that I am?" They answered, some said, "John the Baptist, Elijah, Jeremiah, maybe one of the prophets." That's what the crowd is saying here. He said to the disciples, "Who do you say that I am?" And Peter answered that he was the Messiah. So Jesus is our Messiah. That is the answer. Jesus is our Savior. He saves now. He delivers now. Raise your palms. Wave your palms. Lay your branches and your cloaks before the King of Kings, our King, our triumphal King, our life-giving King, the King that promises us to have eternal life and a hope and a joy and strength for our journey in all circumstances. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. So there's the man he was, the man they saw, and the man he wanted to be. And the ultimate question is, who is this man? Who is this man to you and to me? He's worth following. He is the Messiah. He calls us to serve. He calls us to sacrifice. He calls us to love one another. He calls us to follow after him. And in so doing, he gives us blessing and favor and hope and strength for the journey. Let's pray. Oh God, we do give you thanks for the hosannas that we have, that Jesus saves, Jesus delivers, that he is the Son of David, that he comes on a donkey, man of peace. Peace be with us, peace before us, Jesus Christ. Oh Lord our God, we give you thanks that Christ came and humbled himself. He came from the throne of glory in heaven. And when he entered Jerusalem for the very first time, he was a baby in the womb of Mary, riding on a donkey. And when he entered Jerusalem this week of Passover, the last week of his incarnate life, he rode on a donkey. For us to not miss that this was fulfillment of prophecy, for us to not miss that he is the King of Kings, for us to not miss that he is our Savior, and that he comes sacrificially, the sacrificial lamb, to pay the price of our sin. For that we give thanks, for that we give praise. Amen. We're going to have a time of response, and Adam's going to lead us in a response song. And as he does so, I am going to be looking at your comments on the Facebook feed. I'm going to be reading Messenger comments. I'm going to be getting text messages, I hope, of your praises, your prayer concerns, your fears, things you want lifted up in prayer. I will be praying. Remember that the question today is, who is this? This is the prophet from Nazareth, Jesus. Who is this? This is the Messiah, the Savior, the King, the Son of David, the Son of God. And he's come for us to save us, receive us, to give us hope and give us strength that we can get through COVID-19. We can get through oppressive regimes. We can get through trials and struggles in this life. He will never forsake us. He will always be with us. He's wooing you. He's calling you. This is Passion Week. His passion is his compassion. His compassion for you and for me. that he would lay down his life as a sacrificial lamb. So respond to one another on Facebook live stream, respond in your heart, respond to God, send me your praises and your prayer requests. Adam?
You unravel me with melody. You surround me with song of deliverance from my enemy, till all my fears are gone. I'm no longer a slave to fear. Oh, I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. Oh, I am a child of God. My mother's womb, you have chosen me. Love has called my name. I've been born again to your family. Your blood flows through my veins. I'm no longer a slave.
Sing that again.
You split the sea so I could walk right through it. My fears were drowned in perfect love. You rescued me so I could stand and sing. I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave. I am a child of God.
Amen. And I really appreciate the prayer requests and praises. And certainly I've been praying and will continue to pray for healing for individuals, and healing for our nation. And yes, Brad Dixon, Pastor Brad, it was good to see you joined us today. Shout out back to you, my friend, and to all of you that joined us today. We are so thankful that you've worshiped with us, that you have prayed with us, that you are a part of our faith community. It is our hope and desire that we remain connected to each other in every way possible under the circumstances. To that end, our church is actively working every day to have lessons posted on Facebook. We have our own YouTube channel. We'll send you that connection, the link, the URL address so that you can get on our YouTube. You can follow us on Facebook. You can like us on Facebook. You can share us on Facebook and help others receive these messages, the lessons from many great instructors that are small group teachers in our church and our faith community. We have on our Facebook, also the opportunity for you to join Facebook, our Caremongers group, where we post, I need this, and someone says, I have that, or where you can get it, those things that you may need. We have people on our Caremonger group that are sharing poems and prayers and encouraging and motivational things for us as well, to give us hope each day and to encourage us along the way. Because we are not alone, we have Christ and we have each other. So do connect with us in those ways, and also know that our church family staff are here, available. You can messenger, text us, email us, give us a phone call. We are here together for you and with Christ. So thankful for this opportunity, this wonderful Palm Sunday, triumphant day. Just want to close as a reminder that we always want to remember to give back to our giving and generous God. There's an opportunity for you to do that online through our website. Of course, there's still the mail. We have a Dropbox mailbox outside of the church office. Many ways for us to return as God has blessed us. All good gifts are from God, and we give back to Him. Every blessing that we have is from God. Everything that we have, own, possess, He has given us stewardship over, comes from God, so that we might use it to serve others, to care for others, and to remember, as even Christ taught the disciples, those that are greatest among us are to be least and serve and take care of the flock. And so we do that, and we send you off for a wonderful Passion Week, Holy Week. Remember God, stay in the Word, read your Bible, say your prayers, and stay connected with the church family. Praise be to God. Amen.
Okay, our closing song, we'll sing some more Hosanna. Praise is rising. We'll start with, because when we see you, we find strength to face the day.
When we see you, we find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away.
Let's sing that again.
'Cause when we see you, we find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away. Washed away. Hosanna.